New York after weeks of fear-mongering, shouting lies, death threats, and more. In our fifth story today, the president came face-to-face with a real American who challenged him on health care reform. The stage had been set for a couple of days with a group affiliated with the Tea Party offshoot, Americans for Prosperity, whipping up opposition to greet Mr. Obama when he arrived for today's town hall in Belgrade, Montana. It will be important to see Montanans come out in force to say no to government health care, a member of Patients First told the Associated Press yesterday. Some 1,300 people got inside after a first-come, first-served ticket give-out at two city halls. One of those people, a welder named Randy Rathy, had driven almost all the way across Montana to get tickets so he could confront President Obama. Here's what happened when a real working Joe from a state that represents the real America expressed his real concerns about real health care reform to his president.
My name is Randy Rathy. I'm from Ekalaka, Montana. And as you can see, I'm a proud NRA member. I believe in our Constitution.
Yeah.
And it's a very important thing. I also get my news from the cable networks because I don't like the spin that comes from the mother places.
Oh, you gotta be careful about them cable networks, though.
No.
That's okay. Go ahead.
No.
Go ahead with your question.
Max Baucus, our senator, has been locked up in a dark room there for months now, trying to come up with some money to pay for these programs.
Right.
And we keep getting the bull. That's all we get is bull. You can't tell us how you're going to pay for this. You're saving here. You're saving over there. You're going to take a little money here. You're going to take a little money there. But you have no money. The only way you're going to get that money is to raise our taxes. You said you wouldn't. Max Baucus says he doesn't want to put a bill out that will. But that's the only way you can do that.
Well, I'm happy to answer the question.
Okay. Thank you.
Look, you are absolutely right that I can't cover another 46 million people for free. Two-thirds of the money we can obtain just from eliminating waste and inefficiencies. And the Congressional Budget Office has agreed with that. This is not something I'm just making up. Republicans don't dispute it. And then the other third, we would have to find additional revenue, but it wouldn't come on the backs of the middle class. Randy, I appreciate your question, the respectful way you asked it. And by the way, I believe in the Constitution, too. So thank you very much.
That's right. No death panel crap. No fear of a public option. The Montana audience clapped at the mention of the public option. Just a reasonable question about how to pay for it. And a respectful exchange on both sides based in fact, just like in real America. A point driven home by the last president who tried to do something about health care other than raise the deficit to give billions to Big Pharma. President Clinton speaking to the Netroots Nation convention urging progressive bloggers and online activists to get behind health care reform. Mr. Clinton saying, quote, no matter how low they drive support for this with misinformation. The minute the president signs a health care reform bill, his approval will go up. Secondly, within a year, when all those bad things they say will happen don't happen, and all the good things happen, approval will explode. They know they have no choice to beat, a chance to beat health care this time, unless they can mortify with rigid fears some moderate conservative Democrats. We're looking at you, Kent Conrad of North Dakota. At a town hall yesterday, he told about 100 people he will not vote for any plan with a public option, a vital, perhaps the vital component to the president's plan. Conrad, important at this stage of the game for his role on the Finance Committee, working with ranking Republican Chuck Grassley, about whom more in a moment. Meanwhile, another Democrat from Real America revealed just how committed Mr. Obama is to enacting real health care reform. Iowa Congressman Leonard Boswell at his own town hall recounting a discussion he had with Mr. Obama in February.
We talked about some of these things, you know, whether it's energy or health care or whatever. And the president said, I'm not going to kick the can down the road. And he said that. And I said, well, that's something I'm kind of used to from Southern Iowa. You know, I know about kicking the can down the road. And he said, no. He said, if it makes me a one-term president, we're going to take it on because the country is in need of us taking this on. I respected that very much.
Returning to our program once again on this issue, former Vermont Governor Howard Dean, himself, of course, a physician and former chair of the Democratic Party, who now serves as an independent consultant at McKenna, Long & Aldridge, LLP, providing guidance to clients, particularly in the areas of health care and alternative energy resources. Thanks for your time again tonight, Governor.
Thanks for having me on.
All right. Can you explain or refute, whichever is appropriate, Mr. Clinton's prediction that enacting health care reform will ultimately benefit Mr. Obama and presumably Democrats in terms of popularity and electability in the midterms next year?
everybody likes a winner, and I think President Clinton's political instincts are rarely wrong, and I think he's right in this case. You know, I thought that guy from Montana did America a great favor. I've been doing book signings and speeches around the country over the last few months, and particularly in the last few weeks. And, you know, a lot of conservatives will come, but they don't behave like the people that the teabaggers and the right wing get out. They're real Americans. They have questions. It's a legitimate question to ask how we're going to pay for that. And he deserves a legitimate answer. That's what's going to kill the Republican Party. People want civil dialogue. And, you know, the Republicans apparently don't care about civil dialogue, and they don't seem to care about any dialogue. And I commend that guy from Montana. He's like a lot of Vermonters I know. They just want answers. Mm-hmm. They're not looking to embarrass anybody. They just want answers.
With open access, first come, first serve, what do you make of the fact that that's exactly what he got? He got skeptical questions, the president did. But even in Montana, we didn't get one of the right-wing fearmongers about the wildest thing that was done was the reading of the preamble to the Constitution. It was basically Americans sharing real experiences. Was that grown-ups talking to grown-ups, or why was that different than these things we've seen on the congressional and senatorial town hall level?
I think because it wasn't orchestrated, and because people really want to hear from their president, they want to hear from these congresspeople. I think the biggest problem the Republican Party is going to have is their image now of people who shout all the time, and that real America's not like that, whether they're conservative or liberal.
Back to Mr. Clinton for a moment. Does he, in fact, have a role to play here, either with progressives or the Blue Dogs, or possibly both?
You know, I think the Blue Dogs have, in general, been pretty constructive. The Blue Dogs have not turned their back on the public option. I'm incredibly disappointed with Kent Conrad, mm-hmm. who I consider to be a good friend. The public option is the only reform left in this bill. If you don't have a public option, it's not worth passing this bill. It's just very expensive. You've got to give Americans a choice, Kent, and you ought to give Americans a choice. You know, I don't understand why, Kent, why you think that you ought to be able to make the choice for the American people. Let them make their own choices about this. They'll do the right thing, just like that guy in Montana. They'll do the right thing.
Where is that going to end up? I mean, is this, you suggested yesterday when Chuck Grassley was already claiming that the end-of-life consultation reimbursements were gone.
Chuck voted for that? Chuck Grassley voted for that in 2003. It exists today in the Medicare bill. That exists today. The so-called death panels exist today in the Medicare. And part of it is because Chuck Grassley voted for it. That is a ridiculous controversy.
Almost everybody who has voiced this came out on the other side of it at some point earlier in their careers, which makes it more
next,
ridiculous.
Keith? What's next is, over the weekend we're going to hear about, or maybe later we're going to hear about, taking people's children and indoctrinating them. We're based on a program that we actually used in Vermont to reduce child abuse and reduce foster care placements and keep families together. I think these people are going over the edge. Well, I really do.
I hate to spring this on you, but Michelle Bachmann already said that with AmeriCorps.
I rest my case.
Yeah, I mean, your prediction has already come true in 30 seconds after you made it. But one last point here about what Kent Conrad said. Is he going to prove to be wrong on this? Whether he decides to vote for the public option or not, is the public option going to be in the bill or not?
It will be in the bill, because at the end of the day, the Republicans, essentially, Senator Grassley said this yesterday, are not interested in being part of this at all. They're just stalling. Senator Grassley turned his back on any kind of compromise yesterday, and pressured by his own party, because I think he actually, left to his own devices, would work something out. And so this is going to be left up to the Democratic caucus to do it, and the majority of Democrats believe you have to have real reform, which includes a public option.
Howard Dean, former governor, former presidential candidate, and one correct prediction already in the books for tonight. Great thanks again for your time, sir.
Thanks for having me on.